Good afternoon. I welcome you to today's Trading Spotlight webinar here together with Abner Markets. My name is Jens Klatt. I'm the moderator here for the upcoming 40-45 minutes around. And today we'll look at a very, very interesting topic, probably right now, especially very interesting topic. The question we want to answer today is how to invest like Warren Buffett. And I think I don't really need to introduce Warren Buffett as an investor, respectively, as who he is. But still, we want to give a short introduction to the person himself and how he became one of the most famous investors of our time, respectively, probably, or it's proven that he's one of the not just most successful investors of our time, but also one of the richest persons living on this planet. And so this is our agenda for today. So first of all, again, the question is, who is Warren Buffett? And then that's probably of higher interest here for most of the attendees is, what is Warren Buffett's investment style? And I also want to give an idea on how to invest like Warren Buffett, what he looks at, and how to use this share intrinsic value plays a very, very important role here in this context. And then we'll look at key aspects of Buffett's strategy. Before we start, that's me. So my name is Jens. I'm the moderator here. I'm in the financial industry for more than 15 years now. Wow, I'm getting old. I'm in this financial industry for quite a while now. Started as an employee with a bank, as a trainee with a bank, in fact, after my after I finished school. And after that, I decided to go to university, study mathematics, and wanted to make my way on Wall Street. The funny thing is that I never entered this career path. After studying mathematics and economics, I started out, in fact, in the retail FX and CFD industry. And that was, in fact, a coincidence. That was more like a job as a working student in the last months before I finished university. And I started out as a translator. What then played in my direction and not guaranteed, but brought me my job as a market analyst to build one of the biggest research arms for a big broker here in Germany, that I, beside my studies, also worked as a trader, as a trading assistant, and not just traded my own personal account, but also professionally as a trading assistant for a big stock broker. So that's what brought me my job then. And they asked, the broker asked, where I first started as an intern for just 3 months, they asked whether I'm interested in building their research department. And I agreed. I mean, that was a nice chance. And in fact, it took on momentum and was very, very successful. And after that, I decided to say, okay, then I tried to go out on my own. I got a name in the German trading industry, especially, was asked whether I want to write a book and all the things connected with this. And today I'm self-employed and I'm very happy to have Abner Markets as my partner here. I'm capable of presenting all this trading knowledge here to a big broad audience, Admiral Markets audience. Admiral is the broker behind this trading series, making all this possible. And why is it noteworthy? So I refer to Germany especially, and I'm located in Berlin in Germany. Admiral Markets is noteworthy here in this context because Admiral has 20 offices around the globe, more than 20 offices, in fact, and is an Estonian broker established in Estonia in 2001, if I'm not mistaken. And then they also founded an office here in Berlin in Germany. And this is where the connection came from, in fact. And why is this especially noteworthy? Because I think when it comes to financial questions, I already said that I come from the not just broker industry, but also I was in banking before, working with many people in this industry, and I know how important it is to talk to them in a language they understand. And that builds trust, in fact, especially when it comes to financial questions. And so talking to someone in your native language, I think, is key for a long-term relationship, positive, profitable relationship for both sides, in fact. And that's where Admiral Markets, with over 20 offices around the globe, comes into play. And having someone speaking your German language in this case is probably of high interest, besides all the possibilities above that, beyond that, and with English and other languages. And in addition to that, it's not just the customer support, which is outstanding, but in addition to that, it's also the trading conditions, which should be, which you should have a deeper look at when it comes to, especially the DAX. In Germany, we refer to Admiral Markets as the DAX expert. And so definitely worth to give admiralmarkets.com a visit and take a deeper look at the offering from Admiral. So, now we want to start with today's topic. We want to have a look here at the question, who is Warren Buffett? If you haven't heard about him before, it would come as a surprise, let's say. It's like not knowing who is someone like Muhammad Ali, for example, in boxing, or Michael Schumacher in Formula One, for example. So it's like when you talk about trading or investment, especially investing, you usually know where. Yeah, you know who Warren Buffett is, in fact. If you haven't heard about his haven't heard his name, you probably have seen his face somewhere on television. Who is this guy? So he is investor, business tycoon, and philanthropist. Yeah, you know, someone giving away his money. In fact, I'm not sure whether this is still the case, but I heard that he is the second biggest donor, I think, or probably the biggest philanthropist here in the world, beside or after Bill Gates, a very good friend of Warren Buffett, by the way. And so we want to look at his success as chairman and CEO of Berkshire Hathaway, one of the very one of the companies, for example, which is also listed in the XLF. You probably remember that webinar once we had it on ETFs and here on the financial service. And there's a possibility to invest in the US financial service with an ETF, which is the XLF, and the F is for financials. And Berkshire Hathaway has a big part within this ETF, in fact, the stock from Berkshire Hathaway. And yeah, as I already said, he's considered one of the most successful investors in the world, has a net worth as of July 2020 here of 71.8 billion USD. So he started out, I think, in the 1940s, if I'm not mistaken, with something like 5,000 USD. Let's just see. I just check here the slides, whether I have, no, there's no. Oh, well, it's the next one here. He bought his first shares of stock in 1941. I was very sure that I have something on this, I just overlooked it. So at the age of 11, he started, so very, very early on. And at the age of 15, Buffett had a net worth of about $6,000. That was in the 1940s. Do you remember that? So 1945. So if you adjust this for inflation, we're talking about 68,620 US dollar in 2020, given an annual inflation over this period of 3.64. So there's, in fact, a calculator you can use in the internet. I haven't a link available, but just Google something like adjusted for inflation or net worth inflation adjustment. So it should usually get the job done, and you get plenty of calculators you can use there and calculate this yourself. But we don't want to look at the numbers here and his net worth and something which is not of that high interest, because what's probably more interesting is what is Buffett doing differently from others? And the fact that Buffett is considered one of the, if not the most successful investor of our time, has resulted in the fact that there are plenty of books on this topic, in fact. So Invest Like Warren Buffett, Seven Secrets to Investing Like Warren Buffett, and The Warren Buffett Way. here already in the third edition. In fact, what I did was when I prepared this presentation here, I just headed over to Amazon and just typed in Warren Buffett, and then you get all books. And I took these with the most positive feedbacks here. So I'll share still, I will do the following. Just let me head over here. I've prepared all these books already here. I will now share the link, the Warren Buffett way, in the chat box. And for those watching this video now on YouTube, the recording, you will find the, let me just do it that way. You will find the links to the books here in the description box. I will just share them there. Yeah, a little longer, I think, but whatever. Let me just do it that way so that you can have a look yourself after this webinar and just check out these books if you think this is of interest. I have to say, and this is something which is something I'd like to say all the time when I recommend a book. So I have plenty of books in my library, in fact, but none of these here. So this is like I just looked at here the stars. This was the book was given. In fact, none of these books was written by Buffett himself, by the way. Why haven't I looked at books from Warren Buffett here in this context? We have a similar, let's call it guru in Germany. One of the first books I read on investing in this case. So we're a little away from the topic of trading. So we're looking at a higher time frame here, let's say. And so I have read several books from a guy called Andre Costolani. So probably you heard about him also. That's a very, very famous book author here in Germany, but I haven't read anything about Buffett, but more like what's the word for this? Like a biography. I think this is probably a better way to put it. And so again, I haven't read these books myself, but I think most of them will come to the conclusion that Buffett is one of the best, greatest investors of all time, and also share some insights on what he has done. And what we have here now in the upcoming minutes is a wrap up of his investment style, in fact. So the question, what is Warren Buffett's investment style? So first of all, something we also mentioned, I think, or I said here, Warren Buffett is a famous proponent of value investing. So what Buffett does is, in fact, he buys ably managed businesses in whole or in part that possess favorable economic characteristics. What's noteworthy in this context is something you probably, beside all the theory, want to know. So are there informations on recent investments from Buffett in the media? And in fact, it is. And you joined this webinar before I started speaking. And then I saw that I opened another tab here. And I think this is very important to note, because it gives a very good idea on where we currently stand. Some of you probably have followed, especially this potential bubble which built in US equities over the last months, in fact, so the last 5 months. And there's also been some new guys which are using especially social media to talk about the markets and show a broader audience on how they trade the markets. And there's one guy, it's very difficult to say whether it's if it's real or if it's like what's the word for this? It's not ironic. It's like in German, it's Satire. It's satiric. Is this the right word? In fact, I have some trouble with that. So I'm not really good at calling if someone is ironic or if he is, satiric. This is the right word. Yeah, satiric. So it's very difficult to say. To some extent, I think it's real. And a guy who is very famous on Twitter, in fact, has a big, many, many followers there and many viewers on his videos, on his day-to-day, not just recommendations, but talking about the market, is looking at a very, how can we say that? funny way, it's probably a little too positive. It's more is it insulting? Not sure whether we can really use this word here. But he's not talking very positive about Buffett and his investment style, especially after Buffett said that he's currently not looking into bigger investments in US stocks, especially. So you have seen the run. You have seen that the Nasdaq, for example, from its March lows has recovered not just all the losses, but also pushed to new highs. You've probably seen that the Nasdaq is over 20% in the positive territory year to date, 2020. Now it's September. Yesterday we had a sharp pullback. Everyone was waiting for it. It was more like overdue, in fact. But what's very important here to note is that Buffett has been very skeptical about this run. In fact, in general, and he talked about this openly at the last earnings report from Berkshire Hathaway, in fact. And he was looked at very skeptically. And some came up and saying, yeah, well, this is like, yeah, he's getting older and more conservative and probably times have changed. And I see where all this leads to. And Buffett has been underperforming the market also during the new economy bubble. The same is true for Costolani. I'm not really sure. I'm not sure whether Costolani was still alive when this bubble burst in 2000. But to make long things short, so Buffett looks at this whole development, especially when it comes to the current economic recovery. He looks at it very, very skeptically, in fact. And he has made headlines, in fact, in August, when it was said that he's built a quite big position of $500 million here, US dollar, in Barrick Gold Corporation, a gold mining stock. In fact, it's not just that he built a quite huge position in gold, and Buffett has been quite skeptical about gold due to this missing cash flow component. But in addition to that, he also sold heavily shares of US banks, in fact. So when carefully watching at this from a global macro trade perspective, what you can somehow see is he expects gold to rise, and due to the high positive correlation, he expects shares from Barrick Gold obviously to rise. In addition to that, he expects to US banks to underperform. He's not given any time frame, but this is a very, very skeptical trait of the US economy in general, if you look at it. So I will also share here this this link. And you can see, by the way, the timestamp says it's August, 17th of August, 2020. So this is like next Monday, it's a 3 week old article. And it shows perfectly how Buffett, obviously, in my opinion, at least, so it's just, he hasn't talked about that. But what we can say is, let me just here have a look. How do I say that? Barrick, let's call it Barrick Buffett. That's funny. Okay, so here's the link. And the thing is that this is a very, very, especially when someone like Buffett is playing such a trade, it usually says quite clearly what he thinks about the whole situation right now. And it's not just that he's not heavily invested in stocks, especially in US stocks, and not positioned extremely heavily in this current run higher, at least at what we know. But in addition to that, he is also building a position which is obviously betting on a sharper decline. So the current market environment, let's put it that way, the current market environment, in my personal opinion, is also highly manipulated, not just through central banks, but we also take into account that the US election is around the corner, and that especially the current President Trump is willing to do whatever it takes to keep stocks at a very high level. In fact, there is a high possibility, or high probability, in fact, that the incumbent, so the current US president, that if stocks are higher in August, September, and October, so 3 months before the election, which is taking place on the 3rd of November, that the likelihood, if these 3 months ahead of the election are green, and August has seen already a significant positive return with over 7%, I think, the S&P 500, that the likelihood of the current president be the next president is over 80%, in fact. And it's been something I've also mentioned over the year already, also during the corona lockdown, and especially after markets started to recover from May, June onwards. I said, don't underestimate the willingness to massively manipulate stock markets, especially from the Trump administration, just to make sure that he still has something to show to potential voters right before the US election. And somehow it's playing out exactly that way right now. But the sustainability is not necessarily given. And when looking at what Trump, what Buffett is doing right now with his positioning in Barrick Gold and also the reduction of US stocks in this context, I think this is definitely noteworthy and shouldn't be underestimated, in fact. One second, let me just have a look here. Okay, so I'm uncertain on that because I don't know what he did or if he ever had something like introducing brokerage deal or something in the past. I don't know what his business model beside his investing was. So I can't say in regards to what Franjo just said or has written here, I can't say whether this is true or not. So I'm sorry, I don't have any information on that. But let's come back here to Buffett's investment style. So I already give an idea on how, based on what we know from his investment style, how this could be used to give an idea on the current situation. So it's not that Buffett has never been wrong. There have been times he has been massively wrong, in fact. So just Google, for example, Salomon Brothers, that was a big trading house during the 1980s, in fact, and his investment there, he invested there shortly before there was a huge scandal taking place and bringing this whole trading powerhouse, in fact, nearly down. Let's put it that way. So when looking at this play, Barrick Gold, US economy, it somehow fits also my personal view of the current situation, in fact. But let's have a look back at how the investment style looks also in theory here. So Buffett himself has depicted this philosophy here, of spotting undervalued companies, in fact, with the image of a cigar butt. I don't like that picture at all, to be honest, but he said, well, a mostly used cigar ignored by others, but still has a few risk-free puffs left. So I really enjoy cigars, but I don't like this cigar butt analogy, even though I know what he's talking about. And now what we want to do is we want to here have a look at how to invest like Warren Buffett and what he does. So Buffett divides his portfolio into five so-called macro groups. So the first is operating businesses that Berkshire Hathaway, so BH in this case, owns in their in entirety. So at least 80%. So their company, if you want. In addition to that, he also has publicly traded equity portfolio. So where BH's, so Berkshire Hathaway's stake is usually 5 to 10%. And then in addition to that, there's also four companies in which Berkshire Hathaway has significant ownership. So something between 25 to 50%. And then there's also a very, very important component, a cash and equivalent. So treasury notes, for example, a buffer against mistakes, respectively difficult circumstances. So in fact, at the last Berkshire Hathaway meeting, if I'm not mistaken, he was here referring especially to this fourth point heavily. And I said that he's mostly in cash, in fact, which obviously represents a clear idea of on what he sees or what he expects, especially for the US economy, but also for the global economy to take place. And in addition, then there's the fifth component. There's also insurance companies, a source of cheap cash used to fund the ownership of the other assets through the float of the insurance companies, in fact. And so yeah, that's in fact it. So this is how his portfolio looks like, and where he has his how his investment style looks like. What I think is very important, probably especially right now in the current environment, and what we can learn from is that he's not all in on a trade. So let's put it simply. Just imagine you're very skeptical of the current environment in regards to the economy in general, but also in regards to fiat currencies. You expect the US dollar to come down. So what you would do to hedge this or to trade this, let's say, also so-called inflation hedge, probably, or inflation hedge slash as a hedge for your overall portfolio, is that you buy gold, physical gold, probably, and not necessarily paper gold like an ETF, like a GLD or something like that. But it's more like you're buying gold physically, and then you have it at home in your safe, whatever. So another thing is, if you have a strong opinion on that trade, what you could usually say here in this regard is, well, I'm nearly all in because I expect everything to implode. I expect companies to go bankrupt. I expect a massive crash in equities in general. I expect also fiat currencies to implode. So I'm heavily invested in gold. Physical gold positions, and I have this at home, and then I just try to survive a crash. Now the thing is, if you're all in long or all in positioned and have such a long position and such a hedging position in gold physically, you have an investment where you have a position in physical gold, which is not making you any money. So there's no cash flow connected to this. In addition to that, you have to understand that you still have to, let's put it simply, you have to buy bread for your family to feed your family. So you can't go to the bakery around the corner and say, well, here there's 1 ounce of gold, and then I want to, yeah, what exactly? Buy the whole shop? So you see what I mean? So the thing is that this cash and equivalent component is very important here to make sure that he's still in a position to also be capable of probably buy interesting opportunity or a spot, and then also invest in interesting opportunities. For example, after the great financial crisis in 2008, for example. So it's not uncommon that big or governments in this case are not just asking for Buffett's advice on certain policies they plan to install, but also they call Buffett as someone to save a company or to calm down the markets in regards to the overall situation, an economic downturn, for example. What certainly has to be said, and there's where the next slide comes into play here, the so-called share intrinsic value, is even if you ask him to save a company, it depends on his overall outlook. So here in this context, by the way, you can find this graphic also yourself here on toptalk.com. So the intrinsic value in green obviously shows that if he considers the market, or here an extreme situation, the intrinsic value of a company to be given, still the share price does not reflect this, but is in fact too low compared to the overall intrinsic value here, that he then says, this is a valuable investment because I expect over the long term the share price here, or the market price, to return towards the intrinsic value, and thus have a very interesting situation here, or investment opportunity. On the other hand, if the asset is overpriced, I think he would never step up as the as someone saving the company, because if he considers the price of this asset, of this investment, too high compared to the intrinsic value, he would never step up and buy the company, but instead would probably say no, thank you, and I'm not sure. I don't think, due to his very skeptic positioning in regards to derivatives in general, I'm not really sure whether shorting or selling short stock, respectively, buying some kind of put options and something like that, plays a role here in his portfolio. Even though what I know is that Buffett is familiar. I'm not sure whether they are friends, but I think they've been close, at least from a working perspective. In the 1960s, if I'm not mistaken, at Thorpe. He's one of the probably most successful traders, quantitative traders. At Thorpe has been, or is a mathematician, and is the, he's the writer, the author of the two classics, Beat the Dealer. That was the book which was then used as the basic to beat the casinos out of, in blackjack, in fact. And once they kicked him out of the casinos, because he was so successful in doing that, and delivered, in fact, the basic for the film 21, probably have seen that. At Thorpe then said, okay, then I have to go to the biggest casino in the world. And there's where Beat the Market came from then, in fact. And what he describes here is the beginning, the basic of statistical arbitrage, in fact. So buying undervalued shares, for example, and then selling warrants on these, or using warrants as the vehicle here to put on the trade. So for example, if he sees an option being priced wrong back in the 1960s, that was even before Black and Scholes came out with their Black and Scholes formula, in fact, to price options correctly. In fact, he used, Thorpe used this formula already before it was published from Black and Scholes, and found out that both came to the same conclusion, but these two, Black and Scholes, who also received the Nobel Prize for this formula, they published it before Thorpe, while Thorpe was trading on it and making tons of money with it. So it depends on whether you want to have a Nobel Prize or whether you want to make a fortune with that. But Thorpe traded on it, and it's a very similar a concept here. The thing is that Thorpe, as a mathematician, was also asking the question, what's the right position size? And he was using the so-called Kelly criterion, in fact. So in fact, that was invented with his blackjack play, and he used it to optimally position himself, respectively bet accordingly to the given advantage within the deck in the game of blackjack. And then he adapted this formula, where the criterion, to his trading, in fact. And what I know, and there's where Buffett comes into play, they were close, and Buffett himself, I'm not sure whether he was introduced to this concept of Kelly, so the Kelly criterion by Thorpe, but what I know is that he, or it is at least said, that he uses some variation of Kelly to find out the right position within his investments, in fact. And so that given, in fact, makes it likely that he's probably also using some kind of derivative component, probably also has some short selling within his portfolio, even though I'm not very sure about that. So so now let's come back here to the key aspects of Buffett's strategy. So here we have the limit of leverage. That's also something which is very, very important. So when it comes to the derivatives, which are usually connected here to using leverage, in fact, it's noteworthy that Buffett is a very, very prudent investor, initially looking at the potential downside for any investment, which results naturally in a reduced leverage in his trading. And still, as I already said, there are nevertheless rumors that he uses an adaptation of the Kelly criterion to define his position size in investment, and where the connection comes from, that was just presented for me several minutes ago. So limit of leverage, very, very important. Also, when it comes to the usage of derivatives in general, but derivative is not necessarily derivative. So, I mean, when we look at a put option, for example, to hedge a portfolio, to buy insurance, let's say, to buy volatility, then this is a classic way to use a derivative. I think when Buffett referred to derivatives of potential financial weapons of mass destruction, especially after the great financial crisis in 2008, he was talking especially about very complex derivatives as the ones used from investment banks, and which were so complex that no one really saw through them anymore. And no one really knew how much risk he was taking given the position of the balance sheet, in fact, respectively, the overall position of the trading desk when it came especially to these CDOs, the credit default obligations, CDS, credit default swaps, when it came to these products on MBS, mortgage-backed securities, for example. And so all this is what he referred to potentially as weapons of financial weapons of mass destruction. I'm not sure, as I already said, whether this is probably whether he would also say that about classic options like put options, call options. He's also retaining earnings. So BH here, Berkshire Hathaway, includes a retained earnings test in his owner's manual with an idea that a well-managed business can utilize these earnings better than an investor by reinvesting or by repurchasing their own shares, in fact. So this is also a philosophy which is used from Buffett within his what's kind of his a part of his investment style. And I also introduced here the repurchasing of underpriced shares, so higher returns for the shareholders and benefiting from an increase in ownership. So let's assume the following. Let's assume that he already has a position here in this whatever an investment. He's already positioned in share XYZ. And so then he sees that there's a turbulence hitting the markets. For example, great financial crisis hitting whatever. And he looks at the company and he sees that given all the emotions and the massive sell-off which has taken place has pushed the price of his investment below the intrinsic value, making it underpriced. That means nothing more that he adds to his already existing position to make sure that his investment gains not just more momentum in the future and performs better than the average market. But in addition to that, he also tries to make more money and realize higher returns for his investors in this case. And that's it on Warren Buffett. So let's all this sum up and let's have a look here at the lessons which can be learned from the so-called Oracle of Omaha. Probably I heard about Warren Buffett that way. So we haven't yet referred to this, but Warren Buffett is also known as the Oracle of Omaha, in fact. So first, invest in long-term assets that will appreciate the most in value. So value investing, like holdings in private companies, pension funds, ETFs, or angel investments, in fact. And then what he does is he combines this investment with a more strategic portfolio, in fact, consisting of a combination between stocks and bonds, depending on, obviously, how the overall market is doing. So some of you probably have heard about the classic 60-40 portfolio here, where you say you have 60% invested in equities, for example, and 40% in bonds. And this depends on the overall market. So it's not a given that you have 60% in equities, 40% in bonds, but could also vary to an extent that you say 70 to 80%, depending on the overall market performance and how the equity, how the economy overall is doing, and then reduce your, let's call it the conservative component here. And he's still very conservative and as we already said, a prudent investor, in fact, prepares for potential rainy days and holds a cash reserve or cash equivalent, so short-term bonds, in fact, in his portfolio, not just to be capable of being enough in cash to profit from short-term underpriced opportunities, which may arise with the share price dropping below the intrinsic value, for example, but also to be capable to really invest in opportunities once the market is hit by whatever crash or some headwinds, let's call it. And then also identify and create some source of passive income that can be reinvested, like real estate, rent, for example. So all in all, a very, very solid approach, which has still made him one of the most successful investors of our time and one of the most and richest guys we know so far in the investment world, in fact. And something I think everyone can probably, especially right now, take some lessons from and use it in the future. So, for example, let's take me as an example. I wonder where the world is headed now after Corona. I'm sitting down. That was especially when everyone was going crazy. We were talking about probably shutting down the stock exchanges due to the high volatility which happened there. And I just wondered, I sat down and I said, okay, let's just look at what I have in savings. And then now let's have a look at what I think after there's the market calmed down, what is my vision for the future? And then based on my vision for the future, which companies, which sectors are of the highest interest here for me, or which have the highest potential, in fact, tech, but also in addition to that, green energy, let's call it, especially H2O probably. Also some thoughts on mining stocks. So I'm not surprised to see someone like Buffett, in fact, with his approach, looking at a company like Barrick Gold, for example, in this environment. I could really imagine, in fact, here, the mining industry, especially gold and silver, to shoot through the roof, especially if there's further monetary and also fiscal stimulus, and debt to continue to shoot through the roof, in fact. And so this is then something where I then say, okay, these are this is the amount I want to invest. And then I divide it and say, okay, this is the part I put in, let's say, tech. This is the part I put in mining stocks. This is the part I put in green energy stocks. And probably there's also some kind of passive income source connected to that. For example, buying real estate in a favorable environment. And this is how you can build and also grow a portfolio and start to become independent. And potentially, if the portfolio grows over time, then retire being a very wealthy man/woman in this case, given this overall, at first glance, conservative compared to our active trading conservative approach here, give you a chance to live independently from the income sources you just created by this diversification then. So don't forget to join us next time. So Monday, Paul will be here and he will talk to you about also something quite conservative, safe haven assets. So he also will answer the question, certainly, what is a safe haven? So you heard about safe haven currencies, but in addition to that, what's also in addition to safe haven currencies, what are other classic safe havens? And he will also teach especially traders then. So it's not just from an investment perspective interesting, but also from a trading perspective, why it's so important to understand them as traders and how traders then especially can use these safe haven assets and also developments in price and everything around this here to use them to their advantage. Monday, 2 p.m. London, 7th of September, you will learn more with Paul together. Check your inbox for the webinar link. This is for all of you who listen to this right here in the live event. If you watch this video on YouTube, if you just like what you saw, just leave a comment here, but also a thumb up, for example. Please also feel free to ask all your questions in regards to the presented content. Join our Traders Yard community for all your questions. There we are also not just actively discussing topics here within this trading spotlight webinar series, but also on day-to-day trading, in fact, day-to-day business, if you want. And so this is the link to the trading spotlight community. So you can get support after the webinar, first of all. So please feel free to ask your questions right after the webinar there. Discuss trading strategies, upcoming market events. Today was interesting due to the non-farm payrolls. You probably have seen it. You get trading updates, not just from me, but also from Paul, from Marcus. And You get all the recordings of the webinars you probably missed. You can register for free, in fact, and join here on tradersyard.com, and then join our Spotlight community, Trading Spotlight group. And yeah, so that's it on the forum side or interaction side. Further information on our markets can be found on outmarkets.com. Here are the contact details. And at the end, we have to show the risk disclaimer. So that's it from my end. Have a nice weekend. Enjoy yourself. Talk to you again next week, Friday, then the 11th of September. I look forward to it. Have a nice day. Talk to you later. See you.